Hi, I'm Brigitte Kingsley.
And I'm Andrew Simic.
And welcome to the very first episode of our podcast. So we're going to go through every week and talk about independent filmmaking. We've got a brand new project coming out, and we thought that we would let you guys into the entire process.
You'll get to experience with us all the trials and tribulations, the heartbreak of the creative process, as well as the successes that we enjoy.
Yeah. So first of all, we're gonna tell you guys a little bit about our history, how we got started, and how we got into the film industry. So for me, I always wanted to be an actress. I started acting when I was 12 or 13. I begged my parents to get an agent. And then when I got to high school, they allowed me to do it. And so the passion was there from a young age. I then went to York University to study theater acting. And when I graduated, I thought that my career was just waiting for me, and that I would get a leading part in this great film or a great TV show. And when I graduated, I realized that that's actually not how it happens.
Well, there's just so many people that do this. And I remember when I was studying film at York University, you know, they first ask you right away, what do you want to do in the industry? And everyone wants to be a director. I quickly found out that, at least in school, unless you have that capital behind you, no matter what, you're going to be left doing something else. And even though I want to be a director, I thought, well, I'm in school, I might as well learn as much as I can about the other positions. So whenever there was an opportunity to be a cinematographer, I would take it. Whenever there was an opportunity to be an editor, because editing is so close to directing, I was like, let me learn as much as I can about editing, and hopefully that'll make me a better director when I get that shot, when someone picks up the phone and says, Andrew Simic, I want you to direct my movie.
Now, does that ever happen?
It never happens. It absolutely never happens. At least in my experience, that never happens. So what we're left with is we need to go and do it independently, hence independent film.
So now we've done 10 feature films and 2 television series. So we know a little bit about what we're talking about.
I'm going to asterisk that, all right? Because we know what we know. There are other ways of doing what we do. There are maybe better ways, more efficient ways. I don't know. I don't know those ways. I only know my way. And we're pretty good at our way. So what you're going to see and hear about in this podcast is basically how we do what we do. And the key thing, I think, with independent film is you got to find your way of doing it. Because unless you have a lot of money to throw at a project, you're going to have to be creative.
And I think that's the thing. So in order to be a successful filmmaker, the number one trait is perseverance and creativity, like just not taking no for an answer, because believe me, we have seen a lot of no's in our career. So we'll talk a little bit about our first film and how we got it off the ground. So the way I met Andrew was actually in school. So it was, I was in the theater program, like I said, and I put my picture and resume up on the board, and it was the film board. So it was in order to get cast for projects that the film students were making. And
because, like I said earlier, I wasn't going to get a chance to direct, at least not the projects that I wanted to. In fact, I believe it was my second year professor who said, Andrew, no one wants to see your Hollywood crap. So I was like, oh, I guess I'll make my Hollywood crap somewhere else. So I was shooting a movie outside of the university, and I was walking through the hallways, and there's the bulletin board, and I saw Brigitte's headshot, and I thought the look was perfect. She had a good resume, so I ripped down her headshot, threw it in my bag, and took it home.
So that I could not get cast by anybody else, by the way, and didn't.
Yeah, so, but she came in, she auditioned for the part, and she was perfect. We shot the short film, and we kind of just kept in touch over the years.
Well, when I met Andrew, so I had worked with a lot of, you know, different indie filmmakers by this point. I'd audition and do a lot of indie stuff. And the difference between Andrew and Raph, who were the team at the time, Raph is Andrew's best friend, was that they were passionate, and they had really good projects. And when I showed up on set, they had a full, you know, team of real professionals working for them. And I was like, how did these guys do this? And I loved their passion. So I remember going home and telling my parents, like, these guys are amazing. And I wanted to stay in touch because I knew that Andrew had the talent to go somewhere. And then shortly after that,
I don't know what she's talking about.
he does.
And always remember, guys, so blind passion, okay? You don't have to know anything at the time. Just pretend like you know what you're doing, and that will get you
And truly believe, like we believe. So I told Andrew, I was like, you write a script, and it doesn't matter how long it takes me, I will produce it. I will get this project off the ground and done. And so he went off and wrote a project at the time called Asylum, which later became Medium Raw. And we were kids, like we didn't know what we were doing. So we're like, what budget? And we're like, I don't know, 1.5 million sounds like a good number. And so we stuck to that budget and we're like, okay, I'm gonna raise 1.5 million. I'm gonna star in it, you're gonna star in it, you're gonna direct it, I'm gonna produce it. And those were all non-negotiable. So you gotta think of a couple kids going out with zero experience, trying to raise 1.5 million and keeping every big position in the film.
And also, like when we were doing that short film, I mean, we had I had my team of people, and what I mean by that is like I had Jimmy, and he was the guy who was really good at building stuff. So I just need to find another Jimmy like that. It's just a larger scale, right? You find your key people. My co-director of that short film, Rafael, he was great with the camera. I was like, okay, perfect. Not realizing that at that time, it's having someone take that risk on you is a
Almost
challenge all of its
impossible.
own.
Yeah. So, anyways, it actually did take us, I think, from concept to delivery, I think it did take us almost a decade to do. So, in the process, we learned so much and we did a couple films in the process. So, Andrew's friend, Jimmy, decided that he was going to quit his job and help us get this project off the ground. So, we were very creative in terms of approaching investors and approaching people. We started stalking all the rich people in Toronto. So we made a list. And I remember Steve Stavro was at the top of our
Legal
list.
disclaimer: stalking is used as colorful language and is not actual stalking. Just
Yeah, no, I mean, we started figuring out who we should talk to. And anyways, so we knew where this guy's office was. And for people that don't know, Steve Stavro owned the Maple Leafs at some point.
believe so.
Yeah, he was very, very big businessman. And he had an office at the old Constellation Hotel by the airport, and the hotel was empty. All there was in this hotel was his office. And I told Jimmy, I'm like, okay, I know the security guys that work there. So I'm like, we can totally, I know which car he drives, so we'll just park when he's there.
It does sound a
And
lot like stalking, actually,
it's a little
doesn't
bit
it?
like stalking. But so we bought a nice bottle of wine and we showed up one day at the office and we just kind of walked through security and said, oh, we're here to see Steve Stavro. And nobody questioned it because they had seen me at the hotel before. Went up to, I think it was like the 14th floor or something, whatever, walked into his office and I remember there was like a parakeet. And he had somebody answer the door. I'm like, oh, we have an appointment at 1 o'clock. And the guy lets us in. So next thing we know, we are sitting right in front of Steve Stavro. And he's confused because he's like, who are you guys and why are you in my office? And how did all of these security and my door guy let you in? And we're like, bottle of wine. And then we start our pitch. We're like, so we're filmmakers, we're very passionate, we have this amazing script, you're gonna love it, and I think you should invest in this movie. So have a look at our script. And we had this amazing package that had pictures and concepts. And he kind of just looked at us, and I remember exactly what he said. He said, I'm very old, and I have a lot of grandchildren and children, and I have to leave my money for them. So I will not be investing in your film. But leave it with me. I'll have a look, and I'll see if, he was very kind. So we left, and I think it was like a month later, we did the whole thing over again and ended up right back in front of him. And I remember him saying, I need better security. But that didn't work out. So we kept just sort of pursuing different producers, different people, anybody in Toronto that might be able to help us. And then one day, Jimmy's like, look, I saw this independent film called Phil the Alien. It was really funny, and it's this production company in Toronto, and we should go check it out. So I was like, okay. So we get to this company, and it was 99 Sudbury Street. It was this big warehouse space. And we just kind of, you know, walk in, and there's this big guy behind a desk, and I remember he had a flag behind him, and it was an angel with a noose, carrying a noose, and the company called was called Blackwalk. Kind of an intimidating dude, and we got talking to him and showed him a package and everything like that, and he seemed genuinely interested. But by the end of the conversation, he's like, okay, but you know, I still remember him saying, you're not pretty enough to be the lead, so we would have to have a real person, and we can't shoot film because you know that's not right. We'd have to do digital, and you know, started putting all these laws and these rules, and then all of a sudden, I was like, there's no way I'm working with this guy. Forget it. So we walked out of the meeting and went back home, kept knocking on doors, and then I guess it was probably a month later, I get a phone call from this guy, Michael Herlihy, and he's like, hey, did you see your movie yet? And I was like, well, no, but we're still working on it. And he's like, I got a deal for you. You come work at my office for 3 months during the summer. You don't owe me anything. You know, there's nothing that I want. You just have to let me know what you're working on and give me an option to come into that project if, you know, if we can work something out. And I wasn't ready to give medium raw up to his rules. So I was like, okay, medium raw is off the table, but sure. So went to work.
You may ask where I am in this story, and the truth of the matter is that part of, I guess, my luck in all this is that I'm an introvert naturally. It's very hard for me to talk to people and to go out of my comfort zone. And I mean, Brigitte is, those of you who know Brigitte have met Brigitte. She's fun. She's warm, she's excitable, the exact opposite of what I actually am in real life. And so while I'm at home working on the artwork for the packages for our company, she is there with Jimmy pushing our art forward. And I gotta say, like, without that aspect, I mean, I'm just stuck in my own world without an outlet. And I think that's one of the things where, if you were to ask us separately how we got to where we eventually get to, it definitely is as a result of a team effort in both sides. Without Brigitte's persistence and asterisk stalking of people and the willingness to put herself out there for us, I wouldn't have at least the career that I
And
have right
vice
now.
versa. I mean, without his creativity and his talent, I'd have nothing because
She could have
he's
found someone else. I'm
no.
just lucky.
So yeah, so without you know, without Andrew, I wouldn't have my career either because you know, he's all the creative. I'm just selling his product. So I think the luxury that we have is we've got both sides. We've got the business side and the creative side, and you know, it's a pretty great collaboration, and we've both been very lucky. So anyways, going back to our story, we show up to Blackwalk on the first day, and you know, I show up early with all of my stuff, and it was a very intimidating environment because they had a lot of people working there. It was a big company, and they were producing a film, and it was some kind of musical. I remember that. And meanwhile, I was in my office sort of developing stuff. And I recognized very quickly that the musical they were producing was not going to happen because they had some problems with the rights. And
I think there was a licensing issue
yeah, it
for the
was something
music.
that, and I was like, there's an opportunity here because this guy's going to put a bunch of money into a project and this project's falling apart. So I walked into his office and I was like, so Mike, we've got a horror film and we're shooting, you know, in the next 8 weeks. It's you know, it's really great and we'd love to have you on board. And at the time I was shooting a much music show, so I think I had like $30,000 in my bank account where I was gonna put it towards a project. And I basically told him, I was like, look, if I put half, if you can meet us halfway, then we can, you know, collaborate on this. And he said, okay, well bring me a script on Monday. And I call Andrew, I'm like, you've got 3 days to write a script because I totally pitched a project that does not exist. But I had recognized that if we wanted to do medium raw our way, we were going to have to get one project off the ground that could show people that we actually had a feature film. And this project, we just figured we would get it done and give up some of the rights and not really care, you know, what happened to it as long as we got the experience. So then.
So that was the phone call. After that meeting that Brigitte had, she's like, Andrew, I just pitched this horror film. And do whatever you do. I have to hand in the script. I told them we had the script. We're in pre-production for it. I said, oh, okay, go up to your cottage and write. So I took the weekend and I finished it on Saturday evening, a full day in advance. So really,
You wrote a whole script in 2 days, guys.
I mean, because I felt like I had to get it into the hands of other people. I wasn't, again, comfortable just handing over a first draft of the script. So not only did I have to write the script in 5 days, I had to do a couple drafts of it and at least do a couple edits. And so I remember Saturday evening, I turned to Brigitte and I said, it's a comedy.
And I was like,
And
uh-oh.
the thing is when you're under pressure to write something, sometimes you tap into the creative energy, whatever you want to call it. It just flows, and you're not always in control of it. And especially when you have to write that much, you just kind of go with what you know a lot of the time. And at that time in my life, I was contemplating, I guess, a bunch of comedic scenarios. And so I came down and I was like, here it is. But it's not a horror movie. It's a comedy with horror elements in it. And I was like, but here you go. And we had a script reading with a couple of my trusted friends, and they laughed through it. So I thought that we were on the right track with that. And I was like, well, let's see what happens.
So Monday morning, I give the script and he reads it and comes back and says, it's a comedy. And I was like, yeah, but it's kind of a horror comedy. So he's like, I'm on board. But he's like, you have to shoot. I think he had put us, he's like, you have to shoot in 3 weeks. Be ready to shoot in 3 weeks.
Was it 3? I thought it was less. I thought it was 2 weeks.
It might have,
I
it was
thought it was
basically, he
like,
gave
you gotta
us no
go.
time to prep. And we had never really shot a feature film before. So we hit the ground running and we figured it out as we went. So we're like, what do we need? Well, we need to cast and we need to find locations and we need to get a crew and make a budget, all these things. So we end up casting really quickly, found some great, some great actors that to this day still love. Locations, we basically shot in the executive producer's house and his backyard and his pool and everything around that and his office. And yeah, it was a whirlwind.
Yeah, I mean, everything was just so quick. And I remember when we put out the casting for the lead, Jason Parks, and we gave him, if you guys haven't seen Dark Rising, we gave him the initial speech that his character gives to the young girl about relationships. And I remember we auditioned probably 15, 25 people, and only one person saw that the speech was funny, and everyone else took it so seriously. And Landy Cannon, who plays Jason Parks, he on his audition, he injected that humor and that tongue-in-cheekness, and I was like, that's our character, and that was it. And also, when the Dark Rising series has costumes and monsters, and all of this stuff takes time, and we have 2 weeks to throw everything together. So we really had to schedule it so that all of the Summer Vale and Demon stuff was on the back end of the shoot to allow everything to be constructed. And I mean, we're working on, what was the final budget for,
We
like,
shot it for 65,000, but then I think the final budget, once you start doing all the post-production and the E&O and all of that stuff, was a couple hundred thousand
but in
bucks.
terms of like the actual, like what you're going to see in front of the camera in
Like
terms of about
65
65,
grand.
right? So we don't have that much money to do the demon.
We had $2,000 to do the demon.
Yeah, that's
I
and
remember.
Jim Peacock of Peacock Studios, we had tasked him to do the demon, and I still remember, I was like, I want it to be incredibly scary because it's got to be a horror movie. And as a director, you have this vision of things, and there's the reality, right? You have $2,000 to throw this thing together. And I remember I didn't see the suit until I had to shoot with the suit. That was it. It shows up on set, and that's the suit. There's no feedback. That's the suit. And so I got it, and Jim does this great job. I mean, all it just looks
It
fantastic.
was anatomically correct. yes. in every single
and
way.
And, you know, and I saw it, and I was like, it wasn't to what my vision was at all, but in terms of, the time limit, you kind of just, you have all this energy going towards something in such a short period of time. You're almost, you know, you have to accept what you get. I remember seeing it and going, we are definitely shooting a comedy.
Well, that's what I remember. Jim is one of the most talented people that we know. And he really wraps his head around every creation that he makes. He actually made that wolf behind you. And he's incredibly thoughtful. When it came to the beast, it's like he really had thought out every single part of it. And he accepted that it was a comedy.
Yeah.
Like he knew,
and he had given it this great backstory that I hadn't provided him because everything was like, go, 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 go.
Yeah.
You know, so...
And we should also talk about how, with the casting, when it comes to indie films, one of the most interesting things is who do you put in your movie so that people want to watch? And we had kind of been going back and forth with Jay Riso, which is Christian on WWE, and we had talked to him about being a medium raw. So when Andrew was writing the script, in the back of his head, he had one of the characters that he wrote specifically for him. And we're like, you know what? We'll just throw it out there. If he wants to do it, cool. If he doesn't, that's fine. But we ended up asking him, and he was the coolest guy ever. He, you know, he said yes. He showed up every single week. I think he was shooting.
I think that was the trick too, because we had met with Jay earlier, and he wanted to get more experience in front of the camera acting. He wanted to. Do more acting apart from wrestling, and I'm a huge wrestling fan, so automatically I know what Jay's strengths are in terms of what I know he can pull off, because his character on TV is a hyper realized version of himself. So when I sat down to write Dark Rising, I had Jay already in mind for the Ricky character. So when we were coming to casting, you know, there was this opportunity there that he jumped at, that we saw he jumped at, and it just worked well.
Yeah. And so fast forward, basically this little project that we had really no stake in, that we just wanted to do for fun, ended up being sort of a 10-year journey for us, because without our knowledge, it just kind of started to snowball into this, I guess, I hate to say cult classic, but it had a life of its own where people really, really enjoyed it. Ended up being released internationally all over the place, and it got triggered into a TV series, a sequel, and then another TV series. So the budget went from this like $65,000 initial budget. The last project we did, I believe, was $4.5 million for 5 one-hour episodes. So it really did trigger our career. And part of the way we did that was we did help to create a hype to a certain degree. In terms of when things were moving, we didn't wait. And I think that's important. If things are rolling well, then you contact the broadcasters, you contact everybody, you say, hey, I have this project and it's doing really well, let's do a sequel. And you don't let people any time to think.
Yeah, I mean, I think that so far, just looking back at what we've talked about, a common theme here, just even, you know, listening to your stories about this, has been don't wait. Don't wait for that opportunity. You kind of have to take that opportunity. You have to move forward. Don't wait to have someone ask, you know, well, let's do a sequel. Have the plan. You know, keep moving forward. And, you know, it's like a snowball effect where, you know, you just keep gaining and gaining and gaining.
So that brings us to the next little bit of taking chances and that kind of stuff. So we were still trying to get Medium Raw done. And we had now shot our first feature film, so we had a little bit of confidence. We ended up raising, I think it was $250,000, where we had actually gotten people to invest $250,000 into this project, and we truly believed in it.
Actual people.
Real people. Real money. Sitting in a bank account. It was crazy. And the passion was so real, and now that they had seen this project, then they were willing to do it. And I kind of jump the gun all the time. The reason why we've done so many projects, I think, is because I start to shoot before we have money. I commit to things and just pull the trigger. I don't advise it. This is just our way of making movies, you know.
Yeah, it's actually incredibly, Brigitte will jump into things and start the ball rolling, and I'm the guy who's like, whoa, let's think about this a bit. And the problem is, in a lot of ways, looking back, if you stop to think about it, you're stopped.
You're not going to do it.
You're not going to do it,
Yeah.
right?
So I made Christmas dinners very uncomfortable for about 5 years because what we did is we took this $250,000 and we shot the first 10 minutes of medium raw. Okay, 10 minutes. So we spent, I want to say we spent $20,000 bringing John Rhys-Davies over on a plane from the UK. He's a wonderful man. Very expensive to travel. And then we spent, I think, $50,000 on his fee. And so that was the first $70,000. And then we had the rest of the money to shoot for a week, and we had trailers because we didn't know indie filmmaking. People were telling us we needed to pay, people X amount of money for this, and we needed trailers. So I was like, okay, well, we need a trailer. Anyways, that money went by very, very, very fast. And but at the end of it, we had this great footage, a week of footage with John Rhys-Davies and like this amazing wolf costume. And I was like, no problem. Like, now we just need to find another 1.2 million. This is going to happen very easily. Did not happen very easily. So it literally, we had found a distributor in the US who was going to put $600,000 into it. Learned the hard way that that piece of paper didn't mean anything. No bank would lend against it. They wouldn't give us the money up front. There was nothing I could do with that piece of paper. But I had signed away all the rights to the project, so now I had no rights to give. I had this $600,000 problem. And so, but we had partnered up with Michael for a little bit more long term because of Dark Rising. And so what ended up happening for the next few years is me really and Andrew trying to figure out how to get this project done because there was no option of not shooting it. We'd spent $250,000 of our friends and family and people that we loved their money. So eventually what happened is I had convinced Michael that we could shoot it for, I think I told him like $75,000 it was or something like that. I was like, look, I just need 75 grand. You've got a credit card right here. We can make this happen. And I had kind of broken down the budget and we'd raised a little bit more money. And anyways, I ended up getting him to commit to a location so that we can build. And we had found this really great church downtown Toronto. And Andrew and Jim Peacock, I was like, that's all I need. We'll figure out the rest of the problem. We just need to build this set. So you guys started building, and it took you guys a couple months.
Yeah, and I think maybe this is a good time to reevaluate what we're talking about here in terms of Brigitte kind of glosses over that initial shoot. And I mean, we went from Dark Rising where it was a very low budget, and we were like, okay, well, we're gonna make medium raw for 1.5 million. And when we shot those initial scenes, it was definitely higher budgeted. With Dark Rising, we shot on the Panasonic HVX 200 at the time, which was a 720p camera. I wanted it to not look like video, so we had used the I think it was called the Micro 35 mount, which allowed me to use PL lenses on top of it to give it the film look, even though we were shooting 720p. And our crew was very, very small. And all of a sudden, we're now shooting film, which requires more people. We're paying people a much larger salary. And at the end of that shoot, I had found that like on set there people weren't happier. It was a much, they talk about having larger budgets being more comfortable. And I thought that just in our in the ability to get great footage was far more taxing. And it's something that you don't think about when you're first starting out is so much of filmmaking is actual logistics, moving people and things from one place to another. When you have less people, it is harder to perhaps do the job, but the job of actually the logistics of those people, feeding those people, moving everyone as a unit, it becomes its whole other thing. It's all a whole other process. And after we had shot that initial bit with, you know, John Rhys Davies bringing about fantastic experience. I remember puking the night before. I was acting opposite him and I was puking all night because I was like, this is the second movie I've directed and this guy has worked with Steven Spielberg and Peter Jackson, and there is nothing I can tell this guy that he probably hasn't already heard, you know, and from people far superior than me. So I was just nervous. And overall, the experience was, an experience. Mm. But you kind of have to look at that and say, okay, what are the issues surrounding that, right? I mean, we shot film. Well, right off the top, what's the difference between shooting film and shooting digital? Digital, you can view the footage instantly. You know exactly what you have.
Yeah, and I mean, we spent a lot of money shooting the film, and then we realized that our generator wasn't in sync.
Yeah.
And so we had a flicker.
We had a flicker issue.
On all the stuff with John Rhys Davies, and he was already gone. You know, he left the country, so we weren't flying him back. And we had to be very creative as to how to fix that flicker issue.
You know, and I guess, you know, for, again, those people taking notes at home, it's the jump to a higher budget. It's almost like 1.5 million is still very low budget. And if you're acting like a higher budget, you're leaving yourself up. If there's any mistakes or errors, yeah, you can't actually pay to correct them.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's a very interesting way of looking at it. And then, so for the next part, part of it was all we need is the 75,000 because we were going to shoot it more, Dark Rising style. And also a key development was the introduction of the RED cameras.
Yeah. So when I say 75,000, I meant like, I just needed that to hold us over so that we could have, you know, the location and the build and a few, you know, key things. Obviously, as we ended up shooting the whole movie for 1.5 million is the end of that story, really. But how we ended up working it out is we financed some of the tax credits, which we were lucky enough to have Michael to cash flow that. We built in some reinvestments and we had a few more people throw in some money for some key actors that we needed. But yeah, it was definitely a jump from Dark Rising. So we still have lots and lots and lots to talk about, but I think we're going to wrap this first episode up right now. And next week we're going to jump into the new project that we're doing, how we're doing it, and why we're choosing to do it sort of on the low budget end.
And also, if you guys have any questions specifically about any of the projects we've done in the past, we have 10 years of stories of filmmaking hell. I mean,
fun.
Fun.
Filmmaking fun.
Yeah, it's fun, most of the time. But I think part of the great stories are the parts where it feels torturous.
The trials and tribulations. Yeah. So you can follow us on Instagram or Twitter. Andrew's at Andrew Simic. I'm at B-E-E Kingsley. And you can check out our films. So we've got all the Dark Rising stuff. You can find it on, Amazon, Netflix, whatever. Medium Raw is out there right now. And if you want to buy Night Cries, info at goodsoldierfilms.com. And let us know.